Photoshop has a number of tools that make it easy to remove small distracting elements in an image. In the next few minutes, we're going to take a look at the Spot Healing Brush, the Healing Brush, the Patch Tool, and the Clone Stamp Tool. Now, the Spot Healing Brush is going to automatically select the sample spot for you. So all you need to do is click on the bad spot that you want to remove, and Photoshop will replace it with one of three options, either Content Aware, Create Texture, or a Proximity Match. And the Content Aware technology, I find, typically gives me the best results. I'll use Command-1 in order to zoom in, and then the Hand Tool to reposition this so I'm looking in the lower left. Now, in order to do this in a more flexible manner, I can retouch not on the background, but on a separate layer. So in the Layers panel, I'll click on the New Layer icon. Let's go ahead and just rename that to Retouch. So we know that's my retouching layer. Then I'll want to make sure with all of the tools that I'm using that I have the option to either sample all layers, or some of them have it worded a little different. You can sample the layer, the current layer and below, or all layers. So with that toggled on, I can have the retouched layer targeted, but Photoshop will sample from the background. So now all I need to do is just position my cursor over any of the distracting elements that I want to remove. And when I paint over them, Photoshop is going to use that Content Aware technology in order to remove or replace the area that I paint over with other information. So you might be wondering why every time I paint, my brush size looks large, but I'm actually painting a smaller area. And that's just because I'm using a pressure-sensitive tablet to do this work. If I press harder, then I would get a larger brush there. All right, so just a few more things to remove, and then we'll switch to the Healing Brush. So when I select the regular Healing Brush tool, I don't have that Content Aware technology anymore, because you're actually going to set the point from which you're going to sample. So you are kind of the Healing Brush technology. And like the other tool, we have the option to sample all of the layers. And there's also an option for alignment. So if you have an image that only has a little bit of good source area, you might want to uncheck the aligned option. I'll go ahead and option click to set my source point here in the water, and then I'll paint over this area. You can see now, though, without the align option enabled, when I move my cursor down to maybe replace this rock right here, Photoshop is keeping the source way up in the water, so it's always going to return to that same source. I'm going to undo that using Command-Z and then enable the aligned option. And now when I option click and select or paint over this area to remove it, and then I move to a different area, Photoshop is going to keep the source and the destination in alignment. So you can see I've got the same distance between my brush and those crosshairs, no matter where I move in the image area. All right, the next tool that we should look at is the Patch Tool. Again, we have the Content Aware technology here and the ability to sample all layers. We also have the option to change the structure or the texture, as well as the color of the patched area after we actually apply the patch, which is a little unique because most of the time in Photoshop, these options you have to set before you use the tool. So let's go ahead and patch this area. I'm going to start with this ice in the water and just drag around that area. Then I can click inside and just select the area that I want to patch from. So I'm selecting the source here, but it is also using the Content Aware technology in order to make up the information that it needs to patch that area. And as I mentioned, you can change the structure and the color after the fact. If I move the structure down, you can see there was a pretty dramatic change there. I can also use Command H on Mac, Control H on Windows to just hide the edges as I change these different options. We can see it will recalculate the structure there, and I can also have it recalculate the color, but there's not a lot of color in the original, so I'll go ahead and leave that set to zero. Now, don't forget that you've hidden those edges. I'll use Command H again in order to show them. All right, we can move around and see if there's anything else we want to patch. I'll just select this area here and reposition it. So it's kind of nice because it gives me more control. The other thing that you might want to pay attention to when you're retouching things like this is that you don't just get rid of the ice. You're going to also need to get rid of any shadows. Now, I don't really like that patch job that it did there, so I'm going to select all of that again and just scoot that over. Okay, there we go. I like that better. Now, you may have noticed that most of the pieces of ice that I've been removing haven't been close to the other areas of ice. And that's because if I use the patch tool and I make a selection around this ice and try to remove it, sometimes I get this little blending area along the edge. So in order to avoid that, I can switch to the clone stamp tool. I can just tap the S key in order to select it. It also has the similar alignment options as well as the ability to sample all layers. Now, I find the clone stamp tool to be an excellent way to remove elements because it uses an exact duplicate of another area. And it's the tool that I prefer when there's a lot of good source information. Like in this case, there's a lot of good sand that I can choose from. But it's a little bit more difficult to use because you need to watch for variances in color and tone between the area that you sample for and the area that you're trying to get rid of. So I'll set the source by holding down the Option key on Mac, the Alt key on Windows. I'll just select maybe this sandy area here, and then I can start painting and I'm going to get an exact duplicate. Hold down the Option key again to set a different source point and then just remove those little areas. So you can see when I come along the side of this ice right here, there's no additional blending that's happening. So I'm not getting any artifacting or anything. So I'll go ahead and remove that as well. Again, I'm just holding down the Option or the Alt key whenever I want to set my source. So I'm just looking for areas that would be similar to where I'm laying this down. All right, we'll come right up to there. That was a little too far, so I'll set a sample point a little further below and remove that. All right, I can scoot over here. That should be fine for now. We've got this big footprint though, so let's go ahead and I'll set my sample point and then we can start removing all that area. So one thing you do want to be careful of when you're using the clone stamp tool is that you don't get any repeating patterns. So I might want to go back and just get rid of anything that's obviously repeating because our eyes are so sensitive to texture that we'll pick up those repeating elements and we'll be able to tell, for example, see the little repeating element here and here, we'd be able to tell that that has been cloned. All right, just a little bit more right up here. And I'll use Command Zero in order to zoom out. And we can toggle the visibility of this layer in the Layers panel. So there's before and there's after we've done our retouching. Now, I want to take a moment to save the image. I'll use the File menu, choose Save As. I'm going to append this by just adding an underscore 01 and then saving it back to the local pixel editing folder. I'll save it as a layered PSD file and then click Save. So as we can see, Photoshop's healing brushes and patch and clone stamp tool can be very helpful when removing distracting elements in our images. Photoshop's content-aware fill technology is an excellent way to remove objects in an image and fix areas that are distracting to the viewer. In this image, I want to remove the iceberg in the left as well as the upper right. We can see on the Layers panel that I'm on the retouch layer. I'm going to target the background layer instead. Then with the lasso tool selected, I'll drag a loose selection around that iceberg. From the Edit menu, I'll choose Content Aware Fill. And on the left, we can see our original, and on the right, we have a preview of what it would look like after it's been fixed. So this green area right here is the area that Photoshop is going to be using as the source information in order to fill the area that we have selected. If we want to add to or subtract from that selection, we can use the brush tool. By default, it's set to minus, so that would subtract an area. Every time we paint with this brush, Photoshop will then recalculate the preview area. If I click on the plus icon, then I can add additional areas to be used as the source. All right, there are different sampling area options, auto, regular, and custom. I think auto works really well for the majority of instances, but you can always select one of the other two. We can also choose to sample all layers. So if I was working over an area that I had retouched on a separate layer, I might want to include that sample all layers option. All right, for now, I'll leave it off. You can also make changes to the sample area overlay. You can change the color and you can hide it. You can even invert it so that it would show the excluded area instead. All right, I think it's done a very good job. So I'm going to apply that. And then I'm going to select the lasso tool while we're still in the content aware fill workspace and use the spacebar in order to see this area of my image. And again, I'll just drag a loose selection around this iceberg that I want to remove, and Photoshop will show me a preview of it over here on the right. We can also use the slider here if we wanted to zoom in, but I'm okay with the way it is. There are additional options here for color and rotation adaptation. So if I thought the colors weren't matching, I could change this, either limiting the colors more or telling Photoshop it can make even additional changes to the color in order to create a good blend. We'll take a look at the other options in just a moment. For now, I'm going to output this to a new layer by clicking OK. Now, just one thing to note, we're seeing thumbnails as if it has changed the entire layer, but I'm going to hide the background for a moment. So Content Aware Fill, every time you tap apply, when you tell it to output to a new layer, it will create a new layer. So here we have the fill in the left, and on this layer we have the fill on the right. And of course, this top layer was the retouch layer that we created in the previous movie. All right, let's move to this next image of the river. I'm going to zoom in using Command 1 because sometimes it can be very helpful to kind of assist Content Aware Fill before you go into the workspace. And by that, I mean, in this image, these leaves are going right over this rock area and they're very close down here as well. So if I want to remove this branch, I could help Content Aware Fill by using something like the clone stamp tool and creating sort of a border in between the river area and the rock area. So I'll hold down the option key to set my sample point, and then I'm just going to use the clone stamp tool to just create kind of a difference here, right? So I'm just creating a little bit of separation between what is rock and what is a leaf. All right, once I've done that, I can tap the L key to get the lasso tool, and then I'll just make a loose selection here. Probably want to select that area there to have Content Aware Fill smooth it out for me. But we can see now that there's more distinction between the river area and the rock. I'll choose Edit and then Content Aware Fill, and we can see that Photoshop's done a very good job. Now, I'm going to use the spacebar to scoot this over. There are a few additional areas here that I want to fill. So let's apply the first one, and then let's go and select these leaves right here. Again, I'll tap apply and move to this next leaf, tapping apply again, and then maybe one more time right over here. I might include this area as well. And looking at the preview, I'll go ahead and tap apply. All right, let's apply all of those changes, and I'll use Command D to deselect. If I hold down the Option key, I can click on the eye icon for the background. So that was before, and that's after. All right, one more example, this snail. Here, I want to just drag a selection around this area because I would like Photoshop to fix that so that this line continues along this area. All right, to do so, I will choose Edit, and then Content Aware Fill. But we can see in the preview area that it doesn't look very good. And that's because by default, Content Aware Fill doesn't rotate or scale any of the source information. But we can change that by just setting the rotation adaptation to a different level. In this case, I'll choose full. And by enabling Photoshop to rotate the source information, it's done a much better job at filling that. I can also tell it that it can scale the content, in which case it will adjust it. And again, I think it does a better job. If I had something like a butterfly wing across a horizontal axis, I could also use the mirror option. But for now, let's just apply that. Again, we can see before and after. So as you can see, the content-aware workspace is an excellent tool for removing distracting elements in complex areas. When trying to remove larger elements in an image, it might be best just to copy a really large region of good information in order to replace that unwanted content. So in this image, I think the photograph is really all about the vertical and horizontal lines. So this area over here is quite distracting to me. So I'm going to select the lasso tool and then just drag a large loose selection around this iceberg right here. And I'm going to copy this area to its own layer using the keyboard shortcut Command J, or we can use Layer and then New and then Layer via Copy. Now I'll select the Move tool by tapping the V key and just reposition that copy over the area that I need it to replace. Now, in order to hide all of this information on the Layers panel, I'm going to hold down the Option key on Mac, Alt key on Windows, and click on the Add Layer Mask icon. That will add a layer mask that is filled with black, hiding all of the information on that layer. Then we'll go ahead and zoom in, and I'm going to switch to the Brush tool by tapping the B key. I'll just right-click to make sure that I have reset the tool, and then get a little bit larger of a brush. I'll want to make sure that I'm painting with white at 100% opacity, and now I can just start painting in the mask, and I'm going to be revealing the content on that layer. So we're going to see the copy of the iceberg wherever I paint. So I might want to be a little bit careful down here at the bottom. I don't want to get rid of the water line there. Then I'll come back over here. Now, we might want to look at the mask. I can hold down the Option key on Mac or the Alt key on Windows to view that, to just make sure that we fill in this entire area right here. All right, when we're finished, we'll view the contents of the layer again. And then in order to scale down the content, because this iceberg would be further away, I'm going to unlink the layer from the mask by clicking on the link icon. I'll target the photograph. And then I'm going to use the Edit menu to choose Transform and then Scale. Now we can scale down the contents of the layer, in this case the iceberg, without adjusting the mask. I'll go ahead and zoom out a little bit so we can see what this looks like in relationship to the entire image. If I wanted to flip this, I could also right-click within the transformation handles and choose to flip this horizontally. Because the light is so flat in this image, I'm not that worried about the shadows being in the opposite direction, but I can see some repeating patterns, so I might not want to scale it that small. I'll go ahead and make it a little bit larger, bring it over to the right, and then tap Enter or Return in order to apply it. All right, let's zoom back in there. I just need to make sure I don't need to adjust my mask anymore. I think it could use a little bit of softening on the edge, so I'll target it in the Layers panel and just increase the feather amount. All right, I'll relink the layer with the mask. And there you are, an easy way to replace large elements in an image.